Make sure you guys hit the subscribe button if you guys are enjoying the content that we're throwing up. And make sure you guys hit the like button if you enjoy the video. And yeah, let's begin. Okay, so we are picking up with the conclusion here of Darkseid War. And there's a couple things that I want to talk about here. One, I kind of like doing these older DC stories, the ones that we just never covered, right? That we've heard about, that we've talked about a million times, but never actually covered here, like Trinity War, Forever Evil. Like, we've never really covered those stories. I'm not going to cover Future's End because that story sucks. I read it and it does blow balls. But I kind of like, you know, there's some stuff from the New 52 and DC Comics that's still really good that we never really got around to covering. So I think I might kind of experiment with that a little bit. You know, as you guys know, I love to experiment with you guys and find out what you guys love, because I know there's like 500 of you who are replying in the comics, "We'll watch anything you post, Rob," but then there's like another however many 100,000 people, or really just subscriber count, right? So like 1.9 million people that I'm trying to appeal to and even other people beyond that, right? So doing a YouTube channel or growing a YouTube channel is all about reaching out to an audience that you have and the audience you don't have. So with this, with the conclusion of Darkseid War, we kind of pick up in the aftermath, so to speak, of Green Lantern, right? It's kind of the aftermath of pretty much all the tie-ins. We can cover the one for Lex Luthor. The reality is that nothing really happens in that tie-in. He just kind of comes into his own and fully embraces the power of like the Omega Sanction, right? So like basically becomes full on Darkseid for the most part, not in a direct sense, not in a literal sense, but the power of Darkseid. And like, that's it. That's really all you get. Honestly, Lex Luthor in this is a lot more interesting than he is in his own one shot. But Green Lantern meeting with Batman is really kind of like trying to talk Batman out of the Mobius chair, right? And as we know, Batman doesn't want to leave the chair, because in one part of this, he's kind of addicted to it, all the knowledge that it feeds him, his ability to fight crime as he sees it. But the other part of that is that when he tries to leave, he seemingly physically can't. It's one of these interesting scenarios, but in the middle of their conversation, suddenly Batman chimes in and says, "We need to get out of here. We got to go to Wonder Woman, because right now Superman's just kind of losing his mind." Now, one of the things to remember is that when Superman was bathed in the fire pits of Apocalypse by Lex Luthor in order to help him regain his power, because the idea was the pits are fire, right? They're solar pits, so they should rejuvenate Superman, that he came out corrupted, right? He came out corrupted both in mind and in body. And so his physical powers, his physical abilities aren't really the same they were before. He doesn't really have the same weaknesses, and we'll find out more about that here in a little bit. But in terms of his mind, he's more or less just kind of bent through chaos and madness and anger and wrath, right? Now, Wonder Woman gets the upper hand and manages to bring that in pretty quickly by just wrapping him with the lasso of truth and then just being like, "Who are you?" You know, and he's like, "I'm Superman," you know, and that's basically it. Superman's kind of brought back down. And that was really the point. I know that on the surface, you can kind of look at that and just be like, "Well, that's lackluster." This is not designed to be a Dan Jurgens Death of Superman event where like he comes back with a whole new host of powers. It wasn't really meant to be that way. And one of the things to keep in mind is that DC Comics was like, this story literally leads directly into DC Rebirth. And so we already knew that The Adventures of Superman and Lois Lane by Dan Jurgens was already on the table, and it was already being written and being published. So we knew the idea of blending this version of Superman with the pre-crisis Superman was the intention DC had in the first place. And so it wouldn't really make a whole lot of sense to give him a whole new set of powers, only to wipe those away, then replace them with the old powers, and then call it a day, right? To do that like that, right? To do it within the span of like a year or so. Usually when comics do that, it'll be like a couple years, maybe or so, before they shift things up. So it was just a little too quick of a turnaround. The other part of this is that you have Jessica Cruz, you've got Cyborg, and you've got the master escape artist, Mr. Miracle, basically heading to Bell Reve prison. And the reason for this is that while Big Bart is creating a distraction for the guards up top, the idea of these three guys is to basically get to the cells of Ultraman and Superwoman. Now, Ultraman and Superwoman, and here's one of the biggest travesties of DC Comics, really, like I would say in the last half of the 20th century, is they never explored Earth 3. They never really explored the crime syndicate. We know they're doing it now. They're releasing a series coming up soon that's focused on Earth 3. And presumably it'll give us the story of like how Earth 3 got to the way that it was. It'll give us the ins and outs of how twisted it is and different things like that. So it'll be kind of cool to see that unfold. But up to this point, all we knew about these characters is that like Ultraman gets his powers from kryptonite instead of solar energy, and that Superwoman is basically Lois Lane, right? It's just different things along those lines, just these small little tidbits here and there from this alternate reality. With regards to Power Ring, of course, that's a Green Lantern ring from Earth 3 that's possessed by the vengeful spirit of Volthoom, or at least one aspect of Volthoom. So we know little things about that. Cyborg is basically grid. He's like an evil cyborg in that universe, but we don't really know a whole lot. And so getting some stuff out of this is going to be really, really cool. The problem with this is that as Jessica Cruz has always been someone who struggled to contain the power of her ring, one, because of the fact that the ring has a will of its own and is always trying to dominate the will of Jessica Cruz, and two, because she lacks so much confidence confidence and struggles with so much anxiety that it basically takes away from her willpower, her ability to actually overcome fear. It basically means the ring ends up overtaking Jessica Cruz, and then she's fully under control of Vothoom, operating under the name of Power Ring. Now, of course, once Superman's brought back down by Wonder Woman and they meet with Batman, then one of the little things that we get here, and it's not really important because of the nature of the comic, is that the current structure of Superman's body, the power he possesses, is breaking him down and is inevitably killing him. That's not really relevant because we know he doesn't die just because of the fact that stories we've covered. but what they end up doing is after they kind of get into the cell of Ultraman, Ultraman is actually in a state of panic and freaking out because of the fact that Mobius, Anti-Monitor, is currently on Earth, and Ultraman believes that Mobius knows that he's talking about him, right? Like, anything that could possibly draw the attention of Mobius is enough to scare the heck out of Ultraman. And that's one of the important things to understand. Ultraman, for all the power he possessed, it really was just all glitz and glamour, right? It was just smoke and mirrors. That's all it was. It was just kind of like, look at me, I'm Ultraman, I have all this power. But it was just a false confidence, right? And that kind of comes to bear in the fact that while they faced off against Mobius and he did like eradicate their world, at the same time, if he really was as powerful and really was as confident as he put himself off to be, then he wouldn't be in this current state. Now, some of this also has to do with the fact that because he has not really consumed any kind of green kryptonite, his powers are dwindling in the same way that if Superman's not exposed to a yellow sun, his powers will drop off in the same way. But when it comes to Superwoman, she's actually pregnant, right? She's kind of knocked up. Now, we knew that was the case kind of going through just because of the fact that, she was technically married to Ultraman, but was essentially sleeping behind his back, which kind of makes sense when you're from Earth 3. All you do is just terrible things. And so when that happens, you have Cyborg, who basically tries to override the ring of Jessica Cruz. That doesn't work. And in fact, a portion of his essence is trapped inside the ring. And then he's fully corrupted by the power of Grid, in essence. And then while all that's going on, Mobius finally emerges in what I would refer to as his perfect form. Right now, when Mobius finally emerges, you end up having the cell wall kind of blown open. And that's when Owlman shows up, right? The Earth 3 version of Batman, who's basically like an evil version of Bruce. The reality of this is, even when you take into account Dark Knight's Metal by Scott Snyder, I still say Owlman is probably one of the coolest versions of Batman who exist out there. Again, we don't really know a whole lot about him. We don't really see a whole lot about his character. We will as time goes on. But of course, having this green kryptonite in the possession of Superman, which was technically created by Lex Luthor or captured by Lex Luthor, one, it doesn't affect Superman in his current corrupted form, which is one of the things that's kind of given to us, is that Superman's not vulnerable to kryptonite in this current form. Two, when it's given to Ultraman, it's like a drug. Like, literally, it's like his version of crack. Like, he's scratching, y'all got any more of them kryptonites? Like, that's basically what it is, right? And so as soon as he consumes it, he kind of reverts back to his normal self. And the whole meeting that goes on here, the reason why these two groups are together is because Mobius was powerful enough to eradicate Earth 3, and he's powerful enough to eradicate the main DC universe. The only way for these heroes to come out on top, or at least these characters anyway, to come out on top, is for them to team up, right? For the villains of the crime syndicate to team up with the heroes of the Justice League. Now understand, neither one of these groups is too keen on this idea, right? Neither one of them is like, yeah, I mean, it's cool. They're pretty cool guys, right? I mean, I'd have a beer with Superman, says Owlman. That's never gonna happen, right? Like, they don't really wanna work together. But the reality is, they stand more to lose by working separately than they do by working in unison. Now, while that's happening, the Anti-Monitor is kind of fulfilling his purpose, right? We can just call him Anti-Monitor. Some people might wanna split hairs and call him Mobius. It really is all just the same thing, right? Tomato, tomato. And the whole point behind Mobius as he exists here, he just relishes in destruction and eradicating life, right? Just killing and destroying things, right? Kind of like an evil, benevolent god. And it was really just Geoff Johns' way of taking the Anti-Monitor as we knew him and tying him directly into Mobius and kind of bridging the gap between the original Crisis on Infinite Earths depiction of Anti-Monitor and the way we see him here, especially when it came to new readers, but even those who were asking questions coming in the aftermath of like Sinestro Corps War and things along those lines. And so you have the various heroes who show up here and do what they can. And then you have the crime syndicate who were just like, all we want to do is kill Mobius because he eradicated our world. And for the most part, they're doing what they can where they can, but they are quite literally fighting a guy with the power of a god, right? A man with the power to eradicate entire universes. Now, it's not one of these things that's on the scale of like the Living Tribunal where he just snaps his fingers and a universe is gone, right? It certainly takes time and it takes a lot of energy. But the important takeaway from this is he's well beyond the power of the Justice League. And so where you end up having like Jessica Cruz possessed by Vothoom, who's doing her thing, that one of the things that happens here is that you end up seeing the Green Lantern Corps arrive. Now, the Green Lantern Corps showing up here is really more of like returning the favor of Hal Jordan showing up to Oa and then basically saving the Green Lantern Corps from what was essentially their deaths, and then just kind of undoing everything using a super powerful ring. So that's one of the reasons why we cover that particular tie-in, at least in order to make make this moment make sense. But understand here, even the arrival of the Green Lantern Corps is not enough to really turn the tide of the battle. And in fact, like, there's this massive amount of energy that the Anti-Monitor lets off that wipes out a huge portion of the Green Lantern Corps that's here, and their rings immediately take off and start looking for replacements. Now, while this battle with Mobius or the Anti-Monitor is currently taking place, Steve Trevor is suddenly snatched up by Grail. And the important thing about that is Grail actually has a plan for Steve Trevor and a particular intention that she wants as far as using him goes. But while that goes on, you have Mobius, who ultimately attacks Ultraman and basically talks a little bit of smack to him and then starts to kill him. And where the Flash could step in and the Flash could actually intervene and save the life of Ultraman, the reality is he can't. And the reason why is because while he does have a new host of powers, he and the Black Racer are for the most part kind of working in unison. Not in the sense that like they have the same goal, but in the sense that like one will is able to sort of dominate the other depending on the circumstance. And because the entire existence of the Black Racer is to monitor and wait for death, and to basically whisk those individuals who are supposed to die away to perdition, it doesn't move. And it doesn't allow Barry Allen to move. So Barry Allen cannot step in and save Ultraman, despite the fact that Ultraman being there would be a huge boon for the superheroes in this battle, because he's basically an alternate reality version of Superman, right? So it's like having two Supermen on the chessboard. You can do a lot of damage with these guys. Now, there is a bit of a saving grace that comes in the sense that once Mobius kills Ultraman, then you have the arrival of Lex Luthor, who basically seizes control of all the parademons, right? Who's taken over the parademons of Apocalypse and then is using them as his own personal army. Now, something else to understand, Lex Luthor has all the power of Darkseid here. He's got all this power of Darkseid. But one of the things that Geoff Johns really sort of gives us is this idea that while we looked at the beginning of Darkseid War and we basically saw Darkseid and Mobius facing off against each other and Mobius getting the upper hand, but seemingly there being a kind of stalemate there, that what it looks like is that in this situation, once he's basically freed of the influence of the anti-life equation, that Mobius is basically in his perfect form, right? He's exceedingly powerful. Now, the other part of this, though, is we kind of have to take Lex Luthor at face value. Lex Luthor, despite how intelligent he is and how capable he is, this is the first time he's really wielding a power like this. And so it would be pretty disingenuous to say that, like, Lex Luthor is on par with Darkseid. Not in a perfect sense, right? Darkseid wielded his power for eons, eons and eons and eons and eons. He explored every facet of the Omega Sanction and knew exactly how to use it with surgical precision. When it comes to somebody like Lex Luthor, he's just using it as best he can, right? It's blasts of energy, it's the Omega Beams, right? It's the kind of general thing that he's seen Darkseid do, because he's still sort of learning how to use this power as he has it. And so this kind of lack of experience with the ability he wields basically comes to bear when he faces off against Mobius, and there is a kind of stalemate to a degree, but it's also pretty obvious that Mobius is going to get the upper hand in this bit of a conflict here. Because one of the things to notice is that when it comes to the fight between these two, Lex Luthor is largely resigning himself to physical attacks, as opposed to using more ranged attacks against somebody like Anti-Monitor, which proved to be more successful with Darkseid, right? Darkseid used that exceedingly well to his advantage. Also because Darkseid was more battle-hardened, right? He was more of a master strategist when it came to combat. It doesn't mean Lex Luthor cannot be that way, but there's a difference between a person who's been fighting wars for millions and millions of years and a person who's been doing it for like 35 years or so. And so while that battle is taking place, kind of jumping back over to Batman and to Wonder Woman and Superwoman and Jessica Cruz, or really Volthoom, if you want to call her that, Batman, using the Mobius chair, starts to realize the plan of what it is that Grail's shooting for, but also the significance of the baby that that Superwoman is knocked up with. And so what ends up happening is that once she begins the birthing process and starts to have this baby, that as it comes out and as it's emerged, it comes out as a baby the way that you would expect it to. But Grail suddenly arrives on the scene here. And that's when, like, Black Racer Flash is like, you should all run. And again, the whole reason why he's not moving is he's basically waiting for death. He's waiting for somebody to die, right? Like a person or people are going to die here. And the Black Racer is simply waiting for his time to pull him away. And so what ends up happening is that when the baby's born from Superwoman, that is one of these things where, like, everybody kind of starts to panic, right? And that's because, one, this baby is basically a weapon that that Superwoman intends to use. Two, it's actually something that Grail intends to take. And three, Steve Trevor's back. But Steve Trevor is completely imbued with the power of what is in effect the anti-life equation, combined with whatever power she was able to garner from Darkseid. And so Steve Trevor showing up here, he immediately eradicates Mobius, right? Just like that. Mobius is completely and totally destroyed. Now, the reason why this happens is because if Steve Trevor is infused with anti-life, then seemingly it'd be totally possible for him to just eradicate anybody who's living, right? To basically just destroy their essence. essence. But something else that goes on here is that Superman attacked Mobius prior to this point and basically just dispelled all the apocalyptic energy within his body. That was something that I kind of missed when it happened. That does need to be said for those of you guys who were kind of curious why Superman looks back to normal. So that part's pretty straightforward. But in effect, with Mobius basically gone and eradicated in a pretty lackluster way, if I'm being honest with you guys, the biggest threat now turns directly to Steve Trevor and then Grail. Now, there's also another part of this plan that Grail has, which is pretty amazing, right? It's a pretty genius plan that she has for herself. Single-handedly, she goes through and basically just takes out every single member of the Justice League. And even when the Green Lantern Corps come in and they try to basically lock her down in a cage, because of the fact that her weapon was basically forged by Hades of the Underworld, it can cut through pretty much anything. And it can even cut through hard-like constructs, meaning that she basically just cannot be taken down by these forces of the Green Lantern Corps. And so ultimately we end up learning that with the child of Superwoman, when she basically brings this kid to bear and then starts using him as the weapon that she intended to, then he can basically shout the word Shazam. Now, technically it's Mazaz, right? So just the reversal of Shazam, which makes sense because Earth-3 is the reversal of the main DC universe. And basically he has the power of Shazam, but it's a little bit different in the sense that unlike Shazam, where he basically goes through and like gains powers from other people, the baby can take powers from other people. And so the intention of Superwoman is to basically use her baby to siphon off the power of pretty much anybody else, including Shazam from the main DC universe, and gain his powers in turn. And so when that happens, Steve Trevor basically launches an attack to take out Wonder Woman at the direction of Grail, despite his desire not to do so. And when that takes place, you have Grail who kills Superwoman and then uses the baby and shouts Mazaz. And then in turn, that basically splits the Flash and it splits the Black Racer into two separate beings. When the Flash runs directly in front of the blast that was meant to kill Wonder Woman. Now, splitting the two in half basically sends the Flash out of the equation because now the Black Racer is directly after him, right? So Flash just kind of has to leave in order to keep himself from being killed. And that just sort of continually follows suit, right? That there's a little bit of a reprieve here that the superheroes get trying to figure out what to do. Now, for the most part, Jessica Cruz also ends up being attacked and it's believed that she's basically dead when she's cut down by the Black Racer. But one of the things that had kind of gone on here is that within the ring itself, and even with Jessica Cruz, when Cyborg had downloaded, or at least tried to make contact with the ring and downloaded his essence into it, and Volthoom had taken over Jessica Cruz, that her consciousness sort of existed as a background character, like within the ring itself. And kind of having this conversation with Cyborg and watching everything go on and watching the various heroes seemingly lose in almost every conceivable way, that she ultimately overcame her fear when she stepped out. And so jumping in front of and facing off against the Black Racer the way that she did basically allowed her to overcome her fear of death. And if you're not afraid of dying, you're not afraid of anything, right? So basically she'd overcome her fear in her entirety, which was a pretty significant moment because that's how she became a full-on Green Lantern, right? Which of course we know from our coverage of the Green Lantern stories post Darkseid War. And so following that, it really kind of comes down to Grail, who exercises the final moment of her plan, right? The final intention of her plan. And what she ended up doing was basically following this prophecy that said that the first person who stepped foot on Themyscira was considered quote unquote the chosen one. And so bonding the anti-life equation to Steve Trevor was really nothing more than one, allowing her to destroy Mobius, but two, to basically just kind of keep it safe, right? Just sort of keep it guarded because she knew that none of the members of the Justice League would actively kill Steve Trevor. And so when that happens, she basically ends up taking the baby of Wonder Woman, has it shout Shazam, and then takes the anti-life equation directly out of Steve Trevor in the process. And so the baby basically absorbs the anti-life equation and is totally reborn as Darkseid. And so when Darkseid reemerges here, that it's not really Darkseid as we know, it's Darkseid bent to the will of Grail. Because of the fact that he's kind of dominated by the anti-life equation, he does whatever she tells him to. And that's exactly what happens. Like, she's just like, kill them all, right? So basically, it's now Darkseid and Grail facing off against the Justice League. And so because of the fact that there's so little chance for success here, Hal Jordan does the only thing he can do here, right? With Batman basically being kind of knocked off the Mobius chair, being removed from the Mobius chair, because of the fact that Batman's not directly willing to remove himself from the Mobius chair, what he needs is the willpower to do so. And so Hal Jordan takes his Green Lantern ring and basically attaches it to Batman's finger and says, the universe needs you more than me, right? I'm just a guy who flies and fights. Like, I'm pretty capable and I've got a lot of willpower, but we need your mind. We need your willpower. We need your ability to function as a cohesive member of the team, not some crazy guy sitting on a chair telling us that we're screwed. And so because of that, when that happens, Batman full on becomes a Green Lantern, but it's not something that really, that doesn't really become a mainstay here. And it makes sense because this doesn't really happen until the end of the story. If it had happened at the beginning, I would say Batman Batman would definitely have a more prominent role. But Batman being a Green Lantern here is just kind of designed to help him, one, remove himself from the chair, and then two, to basically find a way to help the superheroes win. Now, Owlman, of course, ends up basically saying, okay, fine, like, everything's done, time for plan B. Bonds himself to the chair, basically takes the essence of Grid from Earth 3, downloads it from Cyborg, and then leaves. And they basically ended up putting it inside of a bot that was created by Lex Luthor. And so from there, Cyborg basically goes back to his normal self. And so Owlman basically bails out, right? He immediately takes off. And I imagine most of you guys know exactly what happens to him. The other part of this is that because the ritual was cast by Grail, the only way for the ritual to be undone is for Grail to undo it herself, which is something that she's not remotely interested in doing, or so it would seem. What ends up happening here instead is that the lasso of truth by Wonder Woman is basically wrapped around Grail and basically compels her to tell the truth, right? Compels her to be honest. And when she does, there's this really, really human moment that happens here where she legitimately believes that she cannot be good, right? She cannot be a good human being, that she has to effectively be a villain. And so when that happens, like, her mother tells her, like, you can do good, right? You can be an actual great person. And so she says, do the thing that you know you don't want to do, but you know you have to do. And she's like, kill me, right? Like, Marina Black is just like, use your power and kill me. Now, the reality of this is that when Grail does this, one, it does pierce Marina Black and kill her, but two, it also kills Darkseid. Now, the reason why this blast kills Darkseid is because it's not Darkseid in his most pure form, right? It's not Darkseid as we're traditionally used to seeing him. Instead, it's just kind of Darkseid, the guy who's kind of a resurrected baby, right? So again, coming into his own, containing the full totality of Darkseid's power had not really been achieved at that point. The other part of this is that because Jessica Cruz had in effect sacrificed her life in order to save the life of Barry Allen and basically overcome her fear of death, and by extension, her fear of pretty much everything else, the Ring of Ulthum, of course, is ultimately destroyed, but she's bonded with a Green Lantern ring and is chosen to become a full-on member of the Green Lantern Corps. Now, this was kind of like the conclusion of the Jessica Cruz story arc, if there really is such a thing in DC Comics. Jeff Johns had paid special attention to her character when he introduced her in. The idea of her and Simon Baz was to introduce, like, new Green Lantern characters that DC could exclusively focus on. The problem was, at the time that they were introduced, DC didn't have any intention or hadn't even conceived DC Rebirth. By the time this story came to an end, it's DC Rebirth comes next. And that's why you don't really see a whole lot of attention paid to Jessica Cruz and Simon Baz in relation to, like, everything else going on in the DC landscape as part of Rebirth. Instead, they were kind of shuffled off to their own story in the Green Lanterns comic book by Sam Humphries, which was amazing. Don't get me wrong, it did not suck. It was an amazing book. It was probably some of the best Green Lantern storytelling that I think I'd ever seen. Like, between Robert Venditti's Green Lantern run and Sam Humphries' Green Lantern run, it was crazy good. Like, it was just ridiculously amazing, especially when you got the origin of Ulthum. If you guys are interested in that, you can check the Green Lantern playlist down in the description. And yes, we will do more Green Lantern. Don't worry, I'm not gonna leave you guys hanging forever. But in essence, it's really just kind of picking up the pieces. The Black Racer is basically out of the picture now, doing its thing, right? It's just kind of off doing Black Racer stuff, whatever the Black Racer does. And the Justice League just kind of picking up the pieces from this massive conflict. There is a bit of an epilogue in the sense that with Grail having killed her mom, but because the essence of Darkseid was kind of dispersed, that it still exists in this sort of child form. And so Darkseid will emerge at some future point in time. But the big takeaway from this, there's two major things that come out of this. The first is that Lex Luthor basically sits on the throne of Apocalypse as quote unquote the new Darkseid. This matters because when you go into Action Comics and Superman Rebirth, those of you guys who are reading the point where, you know, DC Rebirth Superman never trusted Lex Luthor because he always believed he would become Darkseid, that's where this comes from. That's where that particular thing comes from, is this particular moment in the comic right here. The other big thing that comes out of this is the epilogue, which directly set the stage for DC Rebirth in the sense that on the moon, you've got Owlman, who's basically there alongside Metron, the two of them kind of having a conversation of sorts. And what ends up going on here is that while the two of them are talking, that suddenly you end up having this realization from Owlman that, like, he basically says he's here. And while we don't really get an explanation or didn't at the time, suddenly you basically end up seeing Owlman destroyed in the same way that you saw Dr. Manhattan kill Rorschach at the end of Watchmen, right? So that's what people were referencing when they were talking about these little clues and things like that, that Dr. Manhattan's in the DC universe now. And of course, this all directly leads into DC Universe Rebirth number one, right? The one-shot comic that sort of set everything off. But with that being said, guys, we're gonna bring this video to an end. If you guys are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoy this video, make sure you drop a like, and I will catch you all later. Peace.